Welcome to Light Channel, and welcome to another presentation in our series about Signs of the Times. And welcome again, Pastor Jay. Thank you very much for your kindness to come here all the way from Sweden to Denmark.
Thank you.
Today, it's a very special day, I believe, not just for us here in the studio, but for whole Europe, for probably the entire planet we live in. As we speak right now, there is a lot of things going on down there in Italy, in Rome. Maybe some of you here in the audience and people out there already know that today and yesterday there has been meetings going on in Rome. European leaders, the European Parliament, the 27 remaining countries, their leaders are joining Pope Francis in Rome to discuss about the future of Europe. And that was yesterday. And today, they are also in Rome together to sign the latest so-called Rome Declaration. It's a document that these leaders will sign on behalf of everybody, all of us, and also because there's today 60 years of history. They have there is a commemoration of 60 years of European Union, and this is the subject today, but this is not a political discussion. So again, I want to emphasize that we are not a political party here. We don't have a political agenda. We are not trying to make any impact, to influence people one way or another. We are Protestant Christians, and we see and understand the world through these glasses. And I believe it's very important to pinpoint what is happening today, because as we speak, prophecies are being fulfilled.
Definitely.
We're going to come to discuss about that. So as the first picture here is showing, I have entitled this presentation today, Prophecy Countdown, based on an article where the title, as you can see here, Pope Francis to share wisdom with EU leaders ahead of Rome summit, which is happening today. And the article continues here, stating that these head of states and governments are planning to meet with Pope yesterday ahead of a summit which is happening today, expected to provide a vision for the future of European Union after Brexit. A very interesting statement here from the Prime Minister of Malta, Joseph Muscat. He mentioned that the Pope would provide leadership that politicians miss. I do think he, Pope Francis, is the ultimate world leader that within the circumstances has the skills and the vision to say things that transcend the obvious we all say in politics. And this other person, Yves Bertoncini, which is director of JDI, he also said that Pope Francis, he believes that Pope Francis is the only moral authority to provide guidance to European Union leaders. This is from, again, this is a quiet, how should we call it, blatant statement.
Yes.
Pope Francis is the only moral authority. I'm raising the question here.
Yeah.
How do we see that as Protestant Christians? Who is the actual, the real, according to the Bible, moral authority? Do you have any thoughts on that, Jay?
Well, I'm reminded of a prophecy or a verse in Isaiah where it's a prophecy actually about Jesus, and it calls him the mighty God, wonderful, a counselor. So it would be Jesus.
So that would be Jesus according to the Bible and what we believe in.
And I would just like to, for our listeners and viewers, I would just like to explain a Bible verse that has been misinterpreted, and it actually lays at the foundation of much of the behavior of the papacy. Mm. And I think it's worth to share that before we go further, and that's found in Luke chapter 22. And, you know, it's the last days of the life of Christ, and we're talking about Christ and Antichrist. And so those two entities have similar behavior, yet they're entirely opposite. Mm-hmm. And so Jesus was talking to the disciples in Luke chapter 22. I just want to read verse 36. Well, let me read verse 35 also, Luke 22, 35. And he said unto them, that's Jesus speaking now to the disciples, when I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, lacked ye anything? They said, no thing. Mm. And Jesus sent them out with basically nothing so that they would preach the word of God, and they did not lack anything. And then Jesus continues in verse 36. But now he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip, and he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment, and buy one. For I say unto you, verse 37, that this that is written must yet be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. Mm. And so Jesus said, all right, now take your purse, your bag, your scrip, and go ahead and sell them. And what should they buy? He said for them to buy a sword. And it seems like Jesus is saying it's going to be a violent time or a dangerous time to be a Christian. And you know, there were people that were trying to kill Jesus throughout his ministry. And now the disciples answer, and they say, Lord, behold, here are two swords. And he said unto them, it is enough. Mm. How many disciples were there? At this point, there were 11 disciples left. One had gone. Mm. And so there were 11 disciples. But if you take 11 disciples and two swords, it's not really enough, is it? So Jesus was speaking symbolic. He didn't want them really to get a sword. Mm. Otherwise, he said, well, you have two, you need to get at least nine more, or 20 more, so each would have two, one on each side, or each hand. But Jesus said it was enough with two, and later we know that Peter used that very sword of those two to almost kill someone, and Jesus put the ear back on Malchus the servant. And the papacy has used this verse to justify carrying two swords thousands of years. And the one sword, they say, is for the church to keep the saints, you know, under suppression, to keep them in line so they don't do wrong things. And the other sword is for the state. So the papacy believes, based upon this scripture, and certainly they misinterpret others, that they have the power over the state, to use the military power of the state. And that's why there's such an interest in the European Union.
Of course.
It's not only that they have that possibility, but it's an obligation. So it's like their responsibility almost to work together with the kings, the nations, the governments, to enforce what they believe as Bible or their traditions. So that's just a little background to understand why there's an interest of the papacy with the government.
And the history goes back over 1,000 years. And there are a lot of informations. We don't have time now. We only have about 1 hour to cover some of the main aspects with a focus on what is happening today and what happened yesterday. And one of the reasons, some people told me, you know, I was discussing with a pastor yesterday, why is there is so much silence, even within our denomination or the Protestant world so far, that nobody really speaks about it. Yeah. And in our understanding, I believe it's because people have lost track of prophecies.
Yeah.
Either they don't believe that any longer, mm-hmm. Or they join hands, went back to the mother church,
yes.
as they call it. And again, mm-hmm. we're not anti-Catholics. This is not a point here.
No.
We're not here to speak either against Pope Francis or any specific Catholics. We speak here on behalf, because we believe this is our job, is to warn people and to emphasize the importance of the time we live in right now, right here. In Europe,
yes.
So let's move on here. I have here just want to emphasize that one of the persons, this individual that called Pope Francis the only moral authority, maybe people doesn't really remember who this person was. He was actually Jacques Delors. He was the longest sitting European Parliament president, mm-hmm. And he's a Catholic. This is open information available,
yes.
Out there. And if you go on his website, he started a so-called think tank. Maybe which is called the Delors Institute, and if you go on his website, he's actually pretty open with the aim of that think tank. And he said here that we try to form a team which could fulfill two objectives. Firstly, to produce proposal, and secondly, much more difficult, to try to exercise an influence on the governments and member states of the European Union. And again, this is a complex subject. We could jump over to Daniel, you know, we could jump over to the prophecies in Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
I decided not to bring that up today. I just wanted to mention that, because this is not like a prophecy that suddenly it's popping up in the Bible. Or we have some kind of a twisted conspiracy theory that we jump over and take some verses from Revelation or wherever we find them in the Bible and just, you know, mix up something and we come up with some theory. We're talking here about hundreds of years of understanding of Bible prophecy.
Yes.
From the times of the reformers, even going back to the disciples, and to our time today. And I'm just trying to say, just because the Protestant world doesn't believe that anymore, or lost track of this prophecy, that doesn't mean that it's not true anymore.
Exactly.
So some of us, as the Bible says, we are trying here to hold on.
Yeah.
This is ancient truth,
yeah.
You know, based on an ancient book, which before, I just remember, you know, people used to call this the Holy Bible,
yes.
You know, and it has been so attacked over the years and recently. But let's go back to our subject today. Another article I have here, it comes from a news site called Euractiv. It's a pro-EU. Probably, I'm not sure if it's sponsored by the European Union, but they had an article here from yesterday, Rome, a common declaration, but no miracle cure. And they state here, on the next slide here, it's finding common ground for the Europeans' declaration on the 60th anniversary of the Treaty of Rome, it's proving difficult. The bloc's objective is to confirm that European Union is the right answer. But one diplomat said there was no miracle cure, and so on. These leaders of 27 European countries without United Kingdom are due to sign a common declaration in Rome on Saturday. So this is, as we speak, they're going to sign this declaration. And maybe let me just remind some people, maybe they don't know, maybe they have forgotten, that European Union started as a continuation of previous trials. Mm. You know, Rome never gave up to gather Europe under its wings.
Yes.
Okay, so let's go back a little bit into the history, because we know that Nazi Germany and Hitler, they tried basically the same with the support of the Catholic Church. And going one step behind is Napoleon. He tried to do that as well.
Yeah.
So there has been
Charlemagne.
There has been, during the history, several times where they tried through war to gather European Union under the wings of Rome. And as the history is providing us with information, millions of people have died during these processes.
Yeah.
And the last one, we're talking about the Second World War. Mm. And it's amazing. It amazes me that people have forgotten the history.
Yes.
And these leaders, they're going back to the same power that over the centuries have shed a lot of blood to try to gather Europe within its wings and power.
Yeah.
And they're still going back. And today they're signing within the same city as they did over and over and over again.
I would just like to interject a Bible prophecy here. You mentioned Daniel, and there's a prophecy Daniel made about 600 years before Christ, around that time. And actually a king had a dream, Nebuchadnezzar. And in the dream, he saw the image of different metals, and down at the feet there were clay and iron mingled together. And there was a prophecy there that that clay and the iron, you know, I don't know if you've ever done any pottery, but you can just imagine trying to mix clay and iron together.
No way.
If you heat it up, the iron will melt and stick together, but the clay won't, it can't be done. And that's actually a prophecy that was in Daniel chapter 2. And I would just like to read verse 43. Daniel chapter 2, verse 43. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And then verse 44, I think I would like to read also. And in the days of those, and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed. So we have the kingdoms of the world trying to mix together with a corrupt church, that's the miry clay. And then we have God on the other side saying, all right, it's enough. Now I'm going to set up my everlasting kingdom. And the point is that Daniel made, that God gave the king of Babylon the dream, was that these nations of Europe would try to unite, but there would be no lasting success. And so what we see in the European Union, it's a futile attempt to hold together two different cultures that are too different from one another, languages, ideas, religions, and it's the European Union is not going to succeed as a lasting union.
Because the Bible said so, and we believe that. The Bible has proven itself over the centuries.
Yeah.
Every single prophecy in the past was fulfilled.
Will be fulfilled.
Mm. And it's not because we are against the European Union as a concept. There might be some of the aspects of cooperation and so and so, which have proven to be quite positive and so on.
Traveling, for example,
exactly.
I can come here.
Very easy to travel and so on. So there are quite few good positive aspects, and we are all for that. The thing is, the problem is that it is based on a futile foundation, as you mentioned, but it is also based on a moral entity which has no ground on the Bible and the truth.
You know, I wanted to mention this during the presentation. I hope it's all right that I do it now. You know, once again, there is scandals in different countries. Priests have misused children. Mm. Priests are homosexuals. And, you know, it doesn't seem like the Pope or anyone is able to address this issue. Now, I realize there's perversion in all churches, among all religions, all people, but it seems to happen, especially in the Catholic Church. And, of course, there's the non-biblical belief that the priest must be celibate. Mm. And the gift of marriage and the true family is deprived of the priest, and so they try to have another avenue to express this behavior. And, you know, it would be nice if the Pope would go around to these different churches and priests and defrock them or put them in prison, and let's get this morality solved first, right? So it's a false morality. There's a double standard.
Yeah, and that's just one of the many examples. We could dig into that, but that's for another subject.
Yes.
Here, what we're trying to do is to understand Bible prophecy within the time that we live right here and right now. And as we mentioned already, I have another article here from Reuters. The article, it's also from yesterday, Keys to the Future, stating here, how to read use Rome Declaration. And there is a link at the bottom if anybody seeing this presentation would like to see the whole article, as well as the other statements we are putting here. And they say that Europe is our common future. European Union leaders will declare Rome on Saturday, and that is today. In a grand statement of ambition, they hope can hold the bloc together following the shock loss of major power, Britain. The declaration will be issued to mark the 60th anniversary of the European founding treaty. And we're going to cover that in a bit. As a Protestant Christian, our common future, it's first of all God, and it's the Bible. Mm. And we are supporting legislation, and we are supporting governments for as long as it goes along with the Bible. The problem is that as we see prophecies going along today, we are moving toward an era where, let's say, normal things such as religious freedom, freedom of speech, are going to disappear.
And I
just heard recently, there is a good friend and pastor of us. I'm sure a lot of people, they know him, Pastor Holmeyer, with his ministry, Keep the Faith. He had a very good video, an article stating exactly this point, that there is a new term pointing to people like us, alarmist.
Yeah.
You know, we are kind of trying to, what term would you use, you know? To make
warn people.
Again, as we discussed before, being a fundamentalist today is being seen as an evil and a bad thing, and you're a terrorist if you call yourself a fundamentalist.
Yeah.
So now there is a movement toward also coining this term alarmist as being negative.
Oh, definitely.
Okay, so if we go out there now and warn people about what's going to happen, according to the Bible, we're being coined as being alarmist.
Yes.
It is essential that we give the Bible a chance to explain the future for us.
Yes.
I would make the claim, because this is also my personal belief, and I know it's yours, it's life essential. Okay? This is a salvation issue, okay? Maybe some people would ask, what do we care, you know, whatever they do down there in Rome, that's not our problem. I'm just continuing with my life. I have my job, my family, my house. That's doesn't concern me.
Yeah.
I have to say wrong. Mm-hmm. That's a very wrong feeling and statement to make, because the decisions that are being taken there down there is going to affect us.
Yeah.
Maybe not tomorrow, but pretty soon.
Yes.
And especially as Protestant. So we've been covering some information so far, and based on this information, I would like you to read the Bible verse, which is the core of this presentation. And we find this verse in Revelation. And I would invite everybody to open your Bible and open it to Revelation chapter 17. And we're going to read from verse 12, because what we're going to read in that particular two verses, it's happening as we speak.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
And if this doesn't wake us up, you know, if this doesn't wake people, Seventh-day Adventists, Protestant as a whole,
yeah,
I don't know what will.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's happening. Mm. We're not talking about 50 years from now, 100 years from now. We're talking about today, right here and now. So yes. Pastor Jay, the verse is here up on the screen. Would you like to read this verse?
Before I read that, I just would like to share a verse in the same book, Revelation 1:3. It says, "Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." So the book of Revelation is a special book, and it promises a blessing. When we read it, when we hear it, that's understanding with the mind, with the heart, and it's following it, it's obedience. So the book of Revelation promises a blessing for us.
And the blessing lies not just in, because people, a lot of people, sorry, just to make a short break on that, it doesn't mean that we are being blessed material. That's not the blessing.
No,
about, you know.
Thank you. That's true. It's a spiritual blessing. It's a hope. It's joy.
Yeah.
It's piety, holiness.
With the end result being eternal life.
Yes. Yeah.
So ignoring whatever is written in that book, that will eventually cost us the eternal life.
Yes.
That's the result of ignoring that. Yeah. So, please continue.
Yes. Well, that was Revelation chapter 17.
17, yes. Verse 12 and 13.
Yes. All right. "And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast." Mm.
And again, well, this is, as we know, we always read the Bible in a context.
Yes.
I decided to take this verse because it has a very important relevance for what we're talking today.
Definitely.
But I would strongly, of course, recommend for everybody to read the whole Revelation book.
Yes.
And to have a full understanding about the whole package of prophecies.
Yes. Yeah.
You cannot just take that text out of the context and say that means so and so.
Yeah.
So we're just jumping into that verse, and I would like to ask you to give just a short explanation, which is Bible-based.
Yeah.
If anybody has a question, either the viewers on YouTube that are going to watch this video, please do ask. You can write us on our email, info@lightchannel.dk, or just put comments on YouTube. We can send you material and information of how to understand Bible prophecy.
Yes.
It's not difficult. It's not impossible.
No.
And again, could you just give us a short description of who are these kings, the beast, the power, they will give it to the beast?
Yeah. Well, just going back to what we read in Revelation chapter 1, verse 3, in the beginning, the foundation is laid, a blessing for those that read, that hear, and do. So obviously we can't understand if we don't understand. So there it is. A revelation. It's not a closed, sealed book. It's a revelation of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And we know that Daniel and John are related in their writing. The prophecy of Daniel, the prophecy of Revelation, which John wrote. The books go together, and so John is taking a lot of things from the book of Daniel, and we see in the book of Daniel, there is history repeated. We have Daniel chapter 2, the image of gold, silver, and so forth. We have the four beasts coming up out of the sea. We have the goat and the ram. I believe it is in chapter 8. So the history is given several times, and this history is kind of repeated again in Revelation chapter 17, the same history that was given in Daniel chapter 2, 7, 8, and so forth. And in the Bible prophecy, these 10 horns are mentioned in Daniel chapter 7, and they're upon the fourth beast. And the horns are representing 10 kings. It says that in the verse we read. So that's 10 nations or 10 political powers. Mm. And it says they have not received a kingdom as yet. And they receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Now, I don't think that's one literal hour, 60 minutes. I don't believe that. I believe it's symbolic of a short period of time, whether it's 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. 3 years, I don't know, but it's a short period of time. And the beast, Revelation 17 is very interesting because it talks about a woman and a beast. And the beast represents a political power, nation, kingdom. We see that in Daniel chapter 7. And here again, the beast is talking about a political power. But there's also a woman riding upon the beast, and this is an impure woman representing an impure church. And the woman represents a religious power, the beast represents a political power, and actually the papacy is both a religious power and a political power. So the woman and the beast, in this verse here, the beast represents the papacy. And The 10 kings represent governments. Mm. Now, there are different theories about this. Originally, when Rome divided, it was divided into 10 nations in Western Europe. The Anglo-Saxons, the Franks, and Lombardy, and so forth. On, yeah. So some would say, well, this is referring to the European Union, what we have now, though there are maybe 27 nations or 26, not longer 10. Others are saying, well, these are 10 divisions over the world. Like we have the European Union, we have the North American Union, the Australian Union, Russia or the Soviet Union, African Union, like 10 different governments around the world. But in any case, the beast represents the papacy, the religious power. The kings represent the nations of the world, and they're going to unite. And it will be the papacy directing what the nations do.
That was a very short explanation, because that could take hours and a lot of seminars to go through. But as I said, there are informations, and we can forward people to this information to have a clear and full understanding. So again, this is not just a statement. This is not just a conspiracy theory. Although a lot of people are calling us conspiracies today.
Yeah.
And we are against the, let's say, the pluralism, you know, the common sense, which is today in the society. But we want to stay on the Bible as the Waldenses, as the Protestants did over the centuries, because that's the only foundation we can build on. Further, we have an article here from Huffington Post, 24th of September. That was just the day after Pope Francis had his famous speech in the White House in Washington. They state here that the Argentinian Jesuit priest named Jorge Mario Bergoglio, Pope Francis, showed Thursday that he's running to become the president of the planet. He did so in a congressional ceremony of secular civic pomp in a massive legislative building that, after all, harks back to ancient Rome. Okay. This is a secular newspaper, okay?
Yeah.
I have no information about the journalist, the person that wrote this article.
Mm-hmm.
But when I found this article, I found it very interesting, because it's pointing exactly to the Bible prophecy, which is the subject of our presentation today. So again, I have to ask this question. If this prophetic events happening right here and now doesn't wake people up.
Hmm.
And I want, while you were doing this explanation of prophecy, A thought came to my mind. I had recently a conversation with a friend here in Denmark. He's not a Christian, but he was asking exactly this question. What will happen to Europe in the near future? What will happen to the world? Mm-hmm. How am I going to leave a legacy to my children here? And I wasn't there to discuss religion with him. I was there to help him with something else. But I had to stop and tell him from the very beginning, you know what? I tell him, I strongly believe I have the answer to your question. I know what is going to happen. We know these people. We know the background. It's not because we have some kind of inside information. You know, this information, it's available for everybody. Mm-hmm. Everybody can look up in the Bible and with the help of the Holy Spirit have a clear understanding about these prophecies, about what's going to happen. But the question is, how important is that for us today if we really believe in the Bible that this is the truth for our time? How essential is that, that we provide this information to people around us? Isn't that related to love your neighbor as yourself? Mm. That you warn your friends, your neighbors, your family about the coming judgment?
Yeah.
Because what is happening today and yesterday, these are some of the final events, as we know from Bible prophecies, that are going to lead to the final judgment.
Yeah.
Because after the European Union, according to the Bible, there is one thing that is going to happen.
Yes.
So doesn't put us as the very end of human history on this planet. I know a lot of questions I'm asking here. Some of them are rhetorical. You're more than welcome to answer if you feel you have an answer right here and now. I'm trying to underline the importance that we are soon going to see the kings of the earth give their power and authority to the papal beast.
It's happening day by day, you know. The majority of the people don't really pay attention to what's happening in the world. They have the job, as you mentioned, the family, the sports, and everything else. But, you know, now all these EU leaders are in Rome. Presidents go to visit the Pope. The Pope travels to many countries of the world visiting the presidents, the religious leaders.
Yeah.
And they are receiving counsel and directions from him.
And people on the streets today, as I was discussing here with my friend, he had actually a pretty good idea that things are happening down there in Rome. He had a pretty good idea that the popes and the papacy as an institution are controlling very much of the institutions of this world.
Yes.
But what he didn't know is why.
Yeah.
That was his question. Why do they do that?
Yeah.
And that's a very important question, and we do have the answer.
Yes.
Because we know who's behind that power as well.
Yeah.
And we have the answer, and this answer has to be presented to people here and now while we still have the freedom to do that. Here we have a prophetic note, a statement that was written over 100 years ago by a lady named Ellen Gold White. And we, as Seventh-day Adventists, we believe that she was a prophet, that God, through the Holy Spirit and His angel, spoke through Ellen White. And she wrote this statement 100 years ago, and if you care to read this statement.
The world is filled with storm and war and variance, yet under one head, the papal power, the people will unite to oppose God in the person of His witnesses. What is it that gives its kingdom to this power? Protestantism, a power which, while professing to have the temper and spirit of a lamb and to be allied to heaven, speaks with the voice of a dragon. It is moved by a power from beneath. These have one mind. There will be a universal bond of union, one great harmony, a confederacy of Satan's forces.
I want to go back, thank you for reading that. I want to go back to one of the statements that was made by, I'm trying to find it here, I think it was on the second slide. We're talking about here political leaders, European political leaders, the presidents of Europe, mm-hmm. let's say so. They made this statement recently and over the years that Pope Francis, papacy, is the only moral authority to provide guidance.
Yeah.
And the statement you were just reading, okay, that was made over 100 years ago, okay, is that prophecy.
Yes.
When Ellen White was writing that these leaders have one mind, there will be a universal bond of union, one great harmony, confederacy of Satan forces.
Yes. Okay.
Is that a prophecy or not?
Definitely it is. Mm-hmm. And we already see it being fulfilled. It's a conspiracy, mm-hmm. a conspiracy against the people of God, against the Lamb, against Jesus. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a conspiracy is usually something that kind of happens under the rug or behind the curtain, and you don't see it. You kind of have to really study and know the Bible to see the conspiracy developing. And but these kings and the Vatican have been conspiring many, many years, and we see it becoming more and more open.
Yes. Yeah. The next slide actually continues this statement here. It's within the same book. Ellen White also, she's making the statement here that on slide 10, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast, referring to the verses we were just reading before. Thus is manifested the same oppressive power against religious liberty, freedom to worship God according to the dictates of conscience, as was manifested by the papacy when in the past it persecuted those who dare to refuse to conform with the religious rites and ceremonies of Romanism. Okay, so I know a lot of people out there, even within our denomination, they call it history trash.
Yeah.
I have to say that, okay?
Yeah.
A lot of people out there, as we said before, they call it a conspiracy, okay? We don't see that, okay? It's not in the media. I have to say, dear brother and sister, please wake up.
Yeah.
You don't see that in the media, in the mainstream media. That's no way they're going to put this information out there. But nevertheless, it's happening. Every truth seeker, you know, every person on this planet will reach to a point where they have to decide which way to go. And I want to move a little bit on here.
Many people, Michael, say that the papacy has changed. Mm. And that's not really true. Mm. Perhaps the way the current Pope presents things seems like it's changed. But really what has changed is so-called Protestantism. And the Bible has no longer been upheld among Protestants that Luther had, sola scriptura, the vision, the church following the Bible. And the church has begun to follow more and more tradition. More and more of the world comes into the church. And the church is asleep. It's worldly. And it can't really see what is happening. Mm. And so the worldly church cannot see that the papacy is still the same, because they have changed.
The methods have changed, okay? Especially after the Second Vatican Council from 62, was it, to 65, the methods have changed. But as we will see, some of the statements which I found here from Catholics, bishops, and writers, and so on, we are going to use some of their own statements. Another article I have here, a recent article from March this year, from Express, United Kingdom, they say that Brussels chiefs are hoping that Pontiff can provide them with the leadership they are lacking to help solve the debilitating crisis tearing the bloc apart. And again, they say here they will meet with Pope Francis on March 24. The day before, they will all gather. Yes. You know, that actually triggered in the Italian capital to celebrate the 60th birthday of EU and launch its rebirth.
Yeah.
As I see it, it's quite a prophetic language. You know.
Yes.
So again, I'm asking these questions here. So if we could put this slide up here, I believe they are very important questions. Why do we even talk about this subject? You know, on the next slide here, why do we even bother to bring this up here? Is it important? Is this relevant for us today, our society, the world as such? And if this indeed is important, why do we not hear about it in the media, in our churches, and so on? Why this silence? Are we trying to revive some kind of a conspiracy here? I believe not. These are all statements that we bring from the Bible. Another Bible verse that I want to emphasize here, we find it in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, because this is very, very important, if you care to read this.
Yes, of course. Revelation chapter 13 verse 8,
and verse 8. And if we bring up the slide here on the screen, slide 13,
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Yes, thank you. So my question I'm stating here, does this mean that all those who give allegiance to the beast, the papacy, are those whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world? Is this a salvational issue, Jay?
Obviously it is, and you know, really there are only two sides, according to the gospel that Jesus speaks there. The sheep and the goats. And the most important thing is that our names are written in the book of life, in the book of Jesus. And that happens when we give our hearts, our lives, we surrender to Christ and ask Him to be our Lord and our Savior and follow Him and obey Him. And then we can have our names written in the book of life. And by default, all that are outside of that book will be lost, eternally lost. And those will all follow this beast power. I mean, some will be dedicated, really believing it. Others will just follow because the majority is following, or others will follow just because they're not following Jesus. So it's not like all are going to be devotedly following the papacy.
So this is not just, again, this is not that us making some kind of a fuss here because we have some conspiracy against the papacy or the Catholic Church. This is going against God.
Yes.
Because there are two ways, as you mentioned, you know, and paying allegiance, paying homage to the papacy. That means, according to the Bible, that your name is not written in the book of life, which is God's record of human beings which are going to be saved.
Yes.
And that's as clear as it is.
Yeah.
We don't need to have any prophetic interpretation about this. I know that a lot of people today in Europe, European Union, doesn't really know and understand and doesn't take the time to go back in history. So I have found here some statements, and we're going to go through them a little bit faster because we already have been spending a lot of time.
Yes.
And I would like to go through these statements. These are very important to have a background understanding about how Europe started here. So on this, the next slide here, the number 15 here, did you know that European Union started as a coal and steel union? This union or plan being named after Robert Schuman was called the Schuman Plan. And it started as a coal and steel union, and it was gradually turned into a political alliance, which was given the name the European Community. So the question is, what will the next title be? The United States of Europe. Mm. And we also know that from the very beginning, prominent Catholic politicians were dominant in the creation of European Union. For example, Jean Monnet, the French Minister of Foreign Affairs, Robert Schuman, mm-hmm. which was the politician mm-hmm. That made the initial plan, the German Chancellor Konrad Adenauer, which mm-hmm. was a very important figure in Europe, but also international, Italian Prime Minister Alcide De Gasperi, and so on. And these later three were also leaders of the Catholic political parties in their respective countries, so-called yeah. Christian democratic countries. And I would yeah. like to underline this.
You know, it's the way Satan works. He uses catastrophes or crisis mm. to bring in false solutions. And here we had the Second War destroying millions of people. Mm. Germany was much destroyed. And
he creates catastrophes. He yeah. creates crisis.
And then he says, well we got to really mm. stop these wars. We're mm. killing each other. That's not so good. So let's start this union.
Exactly. So we have the plan, you know, the, yeah. the Hegelian mindset.
Yeah. And we can see that just happening throughout history mm. in different ways.
And as we speak today, the Satan is using the same method today. You yeah. know, today they call it the false flags operations yeah. as we see mm. around the world. And
we see basically the same development of the United Nations, mm. especially given a thrust after the wars, mm. you know. So the wars were really yeah. to facilitate yeah. the founding of the United Nations, the European Union.
The more conflicts, the more war, the more terrorist attacks, yeah. the more centralizing the power to yes. United Nations yeah. and the European Union. Yeah. The more money governments yeah. are putting into military operation yes. and building up yeah. arsenals and so on and so on,
and
yeah. and so on. The list is very long. We just wish that, yeah. that people would wake up and, yeah. and realize where this is going to lead. Because one thing is for sure, it's not going to lead to peace.
No.
Okay.
Not biblical peace,
and not even on the earth. Earth
false
here.
Peace.
Yeah. The next statement I have here. Did you know that on number 17, Lars Bergqvist, the Swedish ambassador to the Vatican, he said very open that we should know that European Union was founded by devoted Catholics such as Adenauer, the German Schuman, the French Gasperi, the Italian. All of them had the Union of Europe as an object. Okay, that was yeah. a statement made in sure. Sweden in 1991 in the book called The Road to the European Goes Through Rome.
Yeah.
So these politicians, even those that they were not Catholics, they had a pretty clear understanding of
yeah.
who's behind
yeah.
the European Union.
And actually, you know, if we look at the flag of the European Union, it's the blue, dark blue,
surrounded
the color of Mary. And the 12 golden stars, and that's actually taken from Revelation chapter 12.
Mm.
The church, instead of rightfully claiming its place in Revelation chapter 17, claims it's Revelation chapter 12, the pure yeah. woman, yeah. clothed in the sun and with the stars around the head. So that's actually, they say that's Maria or yeah. Mary, and that's why the flag has 12 stars, because there weren't 12 founding nations of the European Union. Yeah.
So this is a pretty smart, genius way of confusing, not just confusing, yeah. but
you know, symbols say a lot.
Yeah.
It's not by accident these things are chosen to show yeah. what it really represents.
Yes. Misleading people. Mm. The next statement I have here is from Sunday Telegraph on August 25, 1991, bears the title, Now a Holy European Empire. Under a large photo, the Pope, it reads, in him we have the most political pope in modern time.
Yes.
And that was not Pope Francis, I don't remember exactly.
It might have been John Paul.
John Paul, probably he was the pope in 91, but
I'm not sure, but I know he was for a long
yes.
time.
And we also know prophetic understanding doesn't really point to a specific pope.
No.
Even the Pope Francis, even there yeah. are a lot of data and information that yeah. points
yeah.
To Pope Francis as being the last pope,
yeah.
but we don't know that for sure.
No.
Another statement we have here is from the Maastricht Magna Carta, and the statement is here that the predominant religion of the Confederation is Roman Catholicism, and its spiritual head is the Pope, to whom all practice the Roman Catholic religion owe allegiance political as well as spiritual. Among current leaders of Europe practicing this religion are Jacques Delors, person we mentioned before, Dutch Prime Minister Ruud Lubbers, both Jesuit educated, as well as Chancellor Kohl, Prime Minister Philippe Gonzalez of Spain, also devout Catholics. These four leaders are products of the Roman Catholic social movement. And the next slide continues, the Catholic social movement believes that there is no noble task than to the unifying of our continent. Two internal commission reports submitted in February 93 to European Union President Jacques Delors argue that ancient religious differences are at the heart of the conflict besetting the Maastricht Treaty on European Union and religion, or at least some kind of peculiar new Euro-spirituality inspired by Brussels. The European community from its inception was an idea in the mind of the Vatican to re-Catholicize Europe. Hmm. Okay.
Very interesting.
So how clear is that statement for us as Protestant Christians?
Yeah.
Where it comes from and the aim of what is behind here. Another statement I have here is on the next slide, 21. Many non-Catholics fear us as a political organization and are afraid that the Catholic Church will dominate and rule. We are working quietly, seriously, and I may say effectively to that end.
Yeah.
The Catholic Magazine, Missionary, June 1909, page 69. So, dear brother and friend, you know, they made this statement, and this is not the only one. This is not the only official open statement that has been made over the years to emphasize that actually they have a political motive behind of what they do, and the end result is to dominate and rule.
Yeah.
This is a statement made by the Catholics in themselves.
Yes.
I have written this question, but it came to my mind right now. I have it in another slide, is that, and I would like to ask this question to you, and you can decide to answer or not. If any political organization today, except the Vatican, if any religious group, if any person today would make these statements, any government, okay, what would happen to them in today's society, in today's world? How would the society, how would the international community would see that religious group that will make this statement today and have made it over the years that their aim is to quietly, seriously, and I may say effectively, rule and dominate the world?
Yeah.
How would that entity, group of people be seen today?
Well, either the people would laugh at it and kind of blow it off, or they would become very concerned about it and put a stop to it.
And probably be bombed to death.
Yes.
By whoever that will be.
Mobs or...
And so on.
Yeah.
The next statement I have here on slide 22 comes also from a Catholic newspaper, Catholic World, 1870. The supreme duty of Catholics is to obey the Pope and seek in every way, and especially by means of the ballot, to render the Catholic policy effective in this country. And that was a statement done in United States.
Yes.
So again, this statement is just one of many that sheds light on the involvement of the Catholic Church in the political world.
Yes.
They never gave up.
Yeah.
That's a fact. Mm. And Again, we do not attack the right of the Catholics to believe in what they want. This is not the point of our presentation here. We are just here to warn against the situation where the church, the Catholic Church, will make use of its power of state, because this is what we've seen today, to enforce a common creed, including the economics.
I know we need to move on with time here, but I really want to share a Bible verse from John chapter 6. You know, just to show the difference between Antichrist and Christ. Yeah. The devil uses deception and force. Those are his two main weapons. He usually tries to deceive first, and if that doesn't work, then comes a force. But that's not the way Jesus, that's not the way Christ operates. His weapon is truth, it's love. And, you know, it's a statement from John chapter 6 where Jesus was with the 12 and he really started to preach some straight truths, eating his flesh, drinking his blood, you know, really giving the heart totally to Jesus Christ, following him wherever he would go, no matter what the cost was. And that was the cost too much, and many went away. They turned around, and the Bible says here, from that time, many of his disciples went back. That's not talking about the 12. It's talking about others outside the 12. And walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. So Jesus did not say, get out the swords, those that have turned back, force them to come back and to follow me, to believe my teachings and to worship me. Jesus didn't operate that way. He gave freedom of choice.
Yes. And to continue our presentation here, some of the last slides we have here, on number 23 here, one of its aims is political influence, and a statement here made of from, we have it from Pope Leo in his encyclical letter of 1890, all Catholics must make themselves felt as active elements in the daily political life in the countries where they live. All Catholics should exert their power to cause the constitution of the states to be modeled on the principle of the true church, which, of course, they believe it's the Catholic Church. So here we see again that the strategy of the Catholic Church is quite obvious. Wants to gain influence through the parliament's institution in order to control the power of the states.
Yeah, and the principles of the church, it's centralization, letting one man or group of men decide. It's no liberty of conscience, forcing the dogmas.
Yeah, exactly, yes.
And that should make us aware.
Okay. And I'm
we're wary of that.
I'm glad you say that, because this is one of the next statements that we have here on the next slide. One of its aims is to reject the national state. Okay,
yeah,
so
that's right.
The world as we see today is not going to exist any longer. No. And that's a fact. Either we believe it or not, either we fight against that or not, this is what's going to happen. And the Catholic priest Fallon, editor of the Catholic journal, Western Watchman, he wrote this in 1912, tell us that in a conflict between the church and the civil government, we take side of the church. Of course we do. Why? If the government of the United States were at war with the church, we would say tomorrow, to hell with the government of the United States. If the church and all the governments of the world were at war, we would say, to hell with all the governments of the world.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a pretty strong statement.
It's a very strong statement.
And
it's a curse.
Straightforward, it's a curse. And again, I would like to ask this question. You know, you don't have to answer, but this is a rhetorical question for whoever is going to watch this presentation. If any group of people on this planet today, either religious, political, or whatever will make this kind of statement today, these people will be put in prison. That's my conviction, pretty straight away.
At least they'll be censored from the internet.
Exactly, and something will happen, you know, but we find this information in the very open, and they make these statements very boldly, and there are no consequences whatsoever, on the contrary.
One thing I would just like to say, Mikhail, is that a lot of your statements are coming from the 1800s, early 1900s, and some people may say, well, that was then.
Yeah.
But part of the reason why you've chosen that statements is the openness of these statements now is hidden. Mm. You can't find statements like that so openly now. And we don't really know what we see on the internet, if it's true or not. But of course, you've taken a lot of the statements of Franciscus that are very open and very straightforward on his agenda. But I just wanted to say, you know, because some people say, well, see, they've changed. They don't make these statements anymore. But the statements are more hidden in our time.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good point. That's a good point. And if we jump over to slide 28, I'm going to jump over some of the statements they make concerning political power. What concerns us and should concern everybody, even if you don't believe in God, if you don't have any kind of religious affiliation, I think everybody on this planet should be, and I'm sure that mostly people are concerned about religious freedom. What about religious freedom? Is this going to continue as we have it today, as we speak here in Denmark, or is it going to change? And as we've been talking about previously, we know that it's going to change. Yeah. Laws are changing. Mm.
Yeah.
The demonization of Islam, you know, bringing Islam on a terrorist platform. Mm. A lot of people today, they see Muslims are being potential terrorists.
Yes.
You know, they talk about Islam as the main enemy of the world today.
Yeah.
You know, and one day this is going to change, because we have heard the statements recently that fundamentalism as a concept has been moved from not just Islam, but also into the Christian communities.
Just as dangerous.
Just as dangerous as we saw some of the statements. So I have one statement here that religious liberty, in the sense of liberty possessed by every man to choose his religion, is one of the most wicked delusions ever foisted upon this age by the father of all deceit. The very name of liberty, except in the sense permission to do certain definite acts, ought to be banished from the domain of religion. It is neither more or less than falsehood. No man has a right to choose his religion. Okay? And the question I'm asking, how can you then convert to Catholicism? Okay? Because they will force you from the birth. So the statements on the next slide continues. Yeah. Shall I hold out hopes to my erring Protestant brother that I will not meddle with his creed if he will not meddle with mine? No. Catholicism is the most intolerant of creeds. It is intolerant itself. And that's a nonsensical statement, I would say, if it's intolerant of itself. That actually, in my understanding, it actually excludes itself as being a religion. That's from this book, The Rambler, Catholic publication from London, England, coded in Romanist versus Catholicism. Another statement I have here on the next slide, it's from the Catholic paper, Shepherd of the Valley, from 1876. We read, we confess that the Roman Catholic Church is intolerant. That is to say that it uses all the means in its power for the extirpation of error and sin, but this intolerance is the logical and necessary consequence of our infallibility. She alone has the right to be intolerant because she alone has the truth, and so on and so on. And one of the last statements I want to read, it's on slide 32, in relation with religious liberty. The Catholic Bishop O'Connor says that religious liberty is merely endured until the opposite can be carried into effect without peril to the Catholic Church. Okay, so I just want to make a break here and have the Bible again, you know, have put the glasses, the Bible glasses again on. And we have read these statements. We know that this happened before in the Middle Ages. And we know that this is going to be repeated again.
Yes.
So our warning again goes back to the Bible. And I want you to go back to Revelation 17, verse 6. And I want you here in our audience, I would like you to invite to open your Bibles to Revelation 17, verse 6. And we're going to read this Bible verse. If you please read that for us, Jay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration.
Exactly. And the next verse we have here from chapter 18, verse 24.
18:24.
Yes.
Yeah. And in her was found the blood of prophets and of saints and of all that were slain upon the earth. Her, that is the harlot or the woman,
yes,
that we see in chapter 17,
yes,
the corrupt church.
Mm. Referring to that church.
The papacy, and it's interesting, Michael, we haven't talked so much about that today, but it says the mother of harlots.
Mm.
And a mother... not all women are mothers.
Mm.
A mother has gone through a special experience at least once, and that is to have a child.
Mm.
In this case, it's a mother of harlots.
Mm.
That she is the mother of harlots. A harlot is a dirty woman.
Prostitute.
Yeah. And here there's more than one. So these daughters of Rome, or the daughters of the prostitute, it's actually talking about denominations, churches that were once Protestant.
Mm.
But they've given up the Bible, and they've gone after the doctrines, traditions of men. And it's not only the papacy that is going to be punished, but it's also these false apostate Protestant denominations.
The daughters.
The daughters.
Mm.
And I would almost say they're almost just as guilty.
Mm-hmm. Even more, I would say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they're following after.
Yes. They have fallen from the truth.
Babylon has fallen, so it's not only the papacy that's fallen, but also these false Protestant denominations. And that's also a warning to you and to me, to us.
Because we know that God and the Bible is going to judge us according to the amount of truth that we have.
Yes.
So being a Protestant, having the truth, promoting that for a certain number of years, and that and then afterwards falling away, that'll bring a higher, if such it is, you know, in God's world, punishment.
Yes, more scrutinizing judgment, so to speak. And it's a warning to us to, you know, set our own houses in order, our own hearts.
Exactly, exactly.
So while we're talking hard about others, we know that we also will be judged according to what we have received.
And this is also another crux of the matter, because the Catholic institution does not respect the liberty of others. We have seen statements, they make this very boldly, and we also know, and we are expecting them, when they regain the power, to reinforce pretty much the same measures as they had in the Middle Ages.
Yes.
And we know that they are going to use force.
Yeah, well, we've read about these... saints, martyrs, that's not only, you know, 100, 500 years ago, it's going to be in our time also. The Bible tells us about that.
And we are dealing here with a model of government that is not based on biblical principles.
No.
Because God loves,
as
you made a statement before.
Yeah.
God's desire is that every person shall make his own decision about what he thinks and believe.
Yeah.
And God in his love, you know, he created that option for everybody, even atheists. They don't have to do that. Okay.
Yeah.
But they're still living under the blessings of God.
And,
you know?
And you know, just the spirit of Antichrist is a spirit of Satan, and his when he went against God, he started to use deception and force, lies, and that's the same spirit that comes into the Antichrist.
Yes.
And they exalt themselves above God, on the same level of God, and even more, even higher than God.
Yeah. And again, I know this is a very complex subject, and we've jumped a little bit back and forth, but we try to stay focused on Revelation 17, which has been, let's say, the backbone of this subject. And I want to close with some Bible verses, because we've been discussing about some very serious stuff here. Mm. You know, this we're talking about legislations that are going to be enforced. We've been talking about religious liberty that is going to disappear. We've been talking about freedom of speech that is going to disappear that as well. And that's why we're here, as today here in Denmark.
Yeah.
We still want to warn people for as long as we can, freely, through the media. And that could bring a lot of people to say, well, what's left then? What am I going to do with my life? You know, everything seems hopeless.
Yeah.
If it's true what you're stating here, if this is what's going to happen to me then, with my family, with the planet as a whole? We might as well go and, you know, whatever, do whatever with our life we want. But we know that there is hope.
Amen.
Okay, so first comes the warning.
Yeah.
Because there has to be a decision made by everybody,
not
just you and me here. We're not just here to have a chit-chat and discussion for our own sake, because I know that we are pretty much in agreement with our beliefs. I want to bring up some verses here that we have on slide 34 here, from John 8:36. Okay. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed.
Mm, yes.
That's the only freedom we can ever even talk about. That's the only freedom. We can talk about religious freedom. We can talk about freedom of speech. We can expect governments today to give us some kind of freedom to live. And we do have that. And
the beautiful thing about this freedom, Michael, it's no one can take it from you.
Mm.
Only you yourself can take it from yourself.
Can decide to...
Yeah, but this freedom that Jesus gives it, we can have it in the midst of a prison, for example.
Yeah. Yes.
Or when we're going to the fire to be burned, or to the guillotine, we can have this freedom in Christ.
Yes. And another verse I have here is from the very known verse here, for God so loved the world, and I don't think we even have to read it. We know just that Jesus Christ has truly showed us that's genuine love. That's the only love. There is no government, no institution, no power in this world, no pope, no pastor, whoever you may think of that can bring you this love. We know that he came as a man. He humbled himself. We know that he was the real true servant and a fellow human. That's for sure. We know that he was called a friend of sinners and customs officials. He didn't have any social justice agenda.
Mm.
He didn't go against any government on this planet.
No.
You know? He didn't start any social movement. And that's a fact. It's not just our statement.
Yeah.
You cannot find in either the Bible or any other book that was written about Jesus Christ that he ever did start any social movement.
Mm-hmm.
To some kind of refurbish this planet,
some
kind of regenerate or rebirth, just to use the terminology that they are using today about the European community.
Yeah.
He didn't come. He came with a plan.
Yeah.
He presented that to people, and that it's up to us to either say yes or no, am I correct, and then to present it to...
He actually told Pilate that his kingdom was not of this world. And that's where he offers in John 3:16 eternal life. And so I would say, you know, to those that we realize what's going to happen and what is happening, and We have a future in the kingdom of Christ, and where there'll be true love, true beauty, true peace.
True peace. And another, the last verse, Bible verse I want to bring up here is from John 14:27. On the next slide here, where Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you." And so the last questions I want to ask here in this presentation is that, have we all experienced this peace? And if not, would you like to experience this peace? That's our one of the last questions we are asking today. And it is possible, because you can do that here and now, and there is only simple answer to that, surrender to Jesus.
Amen.
This is the final answer today, because the only peace, the only real peace and freedom that comes from walking with Jesus, it's something, like you said before, that no man can take away. They may kill us, but they can't take this peace and freedom from us. Because we're talking about eternal life, eternal peace, eternal freedom here. And even if the world is in a turmoil, we see that, and it's going to increase, unfortunately. And a lot of people are going to suffer, are going to be killed, and there's going to be much more suffering than we see today, unfortunately, but we can still have peace of mind.
Yes.
That's not just a promise. We have experienced that.
Yes.
I know you have experienced that. So that's a personal experience. So if you would like, and if you cherish religious freedom and peace of mind, speak up today. Make your decision. Spread the message. Talk to your friends and family and neighbors, and let them know that this is the truth for today. Time is up. Amen. Before we close, I would like just to do a little bit of a presentation. Many of the quotations that I have, we have shown today in our presentation, comes from this brochure here. If you care to put up the slide on the presentation here. The brochure is called Watch Out for a Catholic European Union. And you can find this brochure in English on this website. It's called endtime.net. I don't know how many pages, but here you can find all the quotations, some of the quotations we've been using today, and also a lot of other informations if you want to have a real understanding about the history of European Union, also seen from a religious, political perspective, and that will hopefully bring you, all the viewers that would like to read that and see that, to a clear prophetic understanding about what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you.